Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 533. Tuesdays we've been doing this, talking professional wrestling, mostly WWE, other stuff as it comes, you know, doing this in the Mayhem style. I'm at Sorgatron in Pittsburgh, PA, in Mayhem Studios, ready to get with it with my buddies here. First of all, from Poughkeepsie, New York, the only one on the crew with a future endeavor letter from the WWE. It is Mad Mike.
Sorg, you know what my take, do you know what this is?
Audio people don't know what that is.
I got a golden ticket. I got a golden ticket. I got a golden ticket to see Nakamura.
Did you buy, it looks like, it appears that you bought an entire row of seats at the Barclays Center so you can sit by yourself and stretch out.
Yes.
That is not true. I hate the bust your bubble, Mike. They're not golden, though.
No, that's
they
just
look, they look more saltine to me.
No, Sam, you don't know how things work in New York City, Wheels. You go to Barclays Center and you exchange the whiter tickets for golden ones because that's how Jay-Z rolls.
Oh, I gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, no, that's a real thing.
There you go. Okay. And that person who just got educated on there, that is Wheels, sound guy for the Renegade Wrestling Alliance, coming at us from California, Pennsylvania.
Yes, and I'm back, and I'm back in black. And I survived this storm that seemed to have lasted like 3 hours, and it wasn't a three-hour tour, that's for sure.
Oh, okay, okay. And also, back on the show from an undisclosed location in witness protection roundabouts Dallas, Texas, my guess is he's hiding from Lance Hoyt. He is Eamon Payton, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling.
Well, now I'm not really undisclosed, Sorg.
What?
You kind of just said it.
I did.
But hey, you said it, whatever. You know, you don't understand how witness protection works.
Eamon, they would have not known if you hadn't confirmed it.
See?
You're,
we know how it works.
You're a horrible witness, Eamon.
I am.
How are you, Mr. Thompson?
That's a Simpsons reference, folks. Jesus. No, I'm excited to be back. It's been a long time since I got to talk about wrestling on this show, but I'm here.
Fantastic. And we'll see. It might be a long time further because he's on hotel Wi-Fi.
Yeah, there we go.
We'll see how it goes. We'll see how the internet works from Texas. But
yeah, he's actually trying to use one of those Wi-Fi hubs and say witness protection.
Right. But in the meantime, you all out there will be our witness to this Wrestling Mayhem Show at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to us on all the podcast places, as well as YouTube, Facebook, all kinds of video versions of the show, and all the spinoffs we do, Midweek Wars, Indie Mayhem Show. Yeah, that returns this week, and so much more. Well, we'll see if the Wi-Fi holds out for Eamon. It returns this week. We do have interviews in the can with some good friends, Wardlow from the International Wrestling Cartel with the big Cage Fury show this weekend. And also, you can drop us a line, as so many of you have been lately, 412-206-WMS0, or that email address.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, at Mayhem Show on the Twitter, Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group. A lot of fantastic conversation going on there. And also, you can join us over on patreon.com. You can join us there too, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, about 10 p.m. after SmackDown Live on the East Coast. But yeah, you can join us just like our good friends have and see the stream and interact with us there. And you can also go to patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. You can support the show like 6 people have been. Contribute to it, become part of it, become our boss of mayhem. So many ways you can contribute there too. If you want to get the word out about whatever it is that you are doing, we have levels for that as well. We can help you with that and get your word out to the mayhem Nation. Thank you so much to our friends that have been supporting our show, including the longest Patreon supporter, Antonio Garza of TheWrestlingRevolution.com. Bo Diggity.
Woo!
As well as Ed Burke, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Bobby F. J. Town, and Alex Cars. Yes, that's six. Thank you so much for everybody that has contributed on the show and continue to as we go here. So let's get into the mayhem that is wrestling. Let's talk about something called SummerSlam. To me,
you have heard of it.
If you're like me and found yourself in the SummerSlam collection, it's all about Triple H and Shawn Michaels feud from 2002. Because I got lost on the WWE Network last night, guys, and realized what a tumultuous time it was in 2002, the hot summer of 2002, when the NWO was a thing with Shawn Michaels for about 2 weeks. That was awkward. But anyways, no, SummerSlam is this weekend, and I think it's a curious lineup amid the brand new draft split. I don't know. Well, let's just go with what match are you excited for going into this already?
There's a lot of choices.
Mm-hmm.
We have a little bit, I believe, the count is now for SummerSlam. Most excited. I would probably say, and because they've also built it really well, both on the show and outside of it, the women's match, or the women's time match, I should say.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah. I like that. What about you, Wheels?
I'm going to say the match I'm really looking forward to, honestly, the women's match, and of course, the Seth versus Finn Balor match.
Okay, what about you, Mike?
I'm honestly not sure. Like,
so we have to choose, right?
I feel like so many of these need something. Like, I guess the one I'm most excited for is Jericho and Owens versus Enzo and Cass.
Interesting choice.
I think my secondary one, I think it would have to be Finn and Seth, just because I know it's going to be a good match, and I want to see how god-awful that new title looks.
And I want to see that kick-ass entrance by Finn.
Oh, yes. Yes.
It better not be the same one they did on Raw.
I gotta say, I'm definitely...
Oh, you mean the fan that ran in?
Oof. I gotta say, I'm most excited for Finn and Seth, because I think that has the possibility for certainly the show stealer of the night.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to disagree with you a little bit on some, like, these matches meaning a little bit more. Now, and, you know, something like the six women, I almost said diva, so six women's tag match that's coming up that was announced tonight on SmackDown, that I think you guessed correctly who would be involved in it, even though you didn't watch SmackDown. Like, stuff like that, obviously. That's pre-show fodder or something. There's 11 matches on this card right now. 11 matches. Mm-hmm. We've extended to a four-hour SummerSlam with a two-hour pre-show. There's going to be a lot of wrestling there on Sunday night.
Oh, is it a two-hour pre-show?
Yeah, it starts at 5 p.m. 5 p.m. Eastern and 7 p.m. Eastern for SummerSlam itself. So welcome to the WrestleMania of the summer. Which, I mean,
holy yeah,
it is. Absolutely. I mean, between that and what they're doing with TakeOver, it is. It absolutely is. If there was a way for us to have another SummerSlam type of, or I'm sorry, Hall of Fame type event, they would probably do it and book it for three. Well, they already booked for three nights, Stanford Barclay, as it is with Raw. But no, I
can't. Four nights, Org.
Is it four?
There's a night, the SummerSlam concert on Friday night.
Well, there you
Wait,
go.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a SummerSlam concert with Flo Rida.
How do I not know any of this?
Because none of us care about Flo Rida.
Have you been sleeping through the wrestling shows, Eamon?
I've not been paying close enough attention, apparently.
It's in those things that we think are commercials, but they're really not commercials.
Gotcha. Okay. But yeah, I think going to Mike's point, I think it's just because I feel like 1 month or 2 months ago, like, we had the idea of what it was going to look like. It doesn't really look like this. Like, I don't think anyone expected Seth and Dean Dolph, you know, even the women's match, no one expected Sasha to be the champion going into it. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of these matches, I don't think people expected a month ago, 2 months ago.
And maybe that's what they're doing. They're like, hey, everybody's expecting this. We'll give them that.
Right. It was something to shake things up a little bit. The most predictable and probably the most boring, if you look at it that way, and I say boring kind of not objectively here, is Orton versus Brock. Right?
And honestly, I don't know how people can be excited for that match.
Somebody is.
I'm just going to be Randy Orton going out for another 8 months with a shoulder injury. Like, that's all it's going to be.
But
like,
that could be fun.
Wow. Who knows? Let's just not wish injury on Randy Orton. He can't be that bad of a guy.
I'm predicting. Like, it's a hashtag spoiler alert.
I mean, come on. The guy gets hurt taking his trash out.
Yeah, I know. It'd be a better way to go out, actually. But, yeah, it's I don't know. Just some of the I'm actually more happy with the build of Orton Brock than I am with matches like Dean Dolph. Like, I know some people really like it. I don't know. I'm just not into it. It's still just taking me so much to sell me on Dolph. You know, it's just stuff like that's kind of – and it's like – I like Jericho and Owens against Enzo and Cass. I like the potential of it, but I just feel like it came out of nowhere. Like, they announced it last week, and I was like, when did these guys start feuding? Like, when did this happen? Like I don't know. It's just, and like, some of the choices are just kind of weird. Like, Sami Zayn's not on the card at all. Like, I don't know. It's just
yet.
Well, that's because he's finally free of Kevin Owens.
Yet.
Yeah, it's like he won at Battleground. He, like, got rid of this demon, and now he's not on the show in Kevin is.
Yet, there are 11 matches on this card, and we have room for Curt Hawkins to come back on SmackDown.
Is that who's coming? Oh, fuck. Oh. I thought I was on a tweet about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, God. We're going to get Curt Hawkins and Heath Slayer versus the Hype Bros, aren't we?
What is SmackDown doing? Like, some of the choices, I just don't.
Okay. Like, obviously, I got a point. Okay, for Eamon and Mike, not to get too big into SmackDown talk, I want to stay on SummerSlam exclusively for this. But you guys haven't watched SmackDown, right? And I gotta say, I think SmackDown tonight was the best SmackDown since they started the split.
I've seen a gist of SmackDown for tonight.
Yeah,
and probably I would agree with you. There was aspects of the show I liked. It's just I don't understand some of the decision making, like compared to Raw.
It's schizophrenic. Don't get me wrong. No. Absolutely. SmackDown is some of the most schizophrenic decision making I think I've seen in a while. But it felt like tonight a lot of things kind of came through. Okay.
Okay.
I feel like Heath Slater stuff was great. That was amazing. Just a lot of things that you're like from week one, we're like, what are they doing with this? There were a lot of aha moments I felt like tonight. Even to the point where I was not bored by a Del Rio and John Cena match. And neither was the crowd in Austin, Texas. And I want to have a discussion with you, Eamon, about your state in professional wrestling.
they're normally awful, as I responded to
they were not night. Awful tonight in Austin, Texas.
Corpus isn't great. But,
yeah, Corpus.
Good on Corpus for actually giving Charlotte heel heat, though.
There's that, too. Yes, of course.
But other than that, they were dead silent for, like, everything.
It was very, very weird. Yet they made Brock smile. So there's that. But anyways, back to it. From SummerSlam, of course. It seems stacked. There's weight to it. I hate the idea that we have the Universal Championship coming up and everything else like that. But the matches around weird things like that are great. We're getting that. We're getting Charlotte and Sasha. We're getting a Rusev and Reigns. Actually, is kind of
we're
interesting.
Getting a lot of Raw matches on SummerSlam.
Well, that was true. Like, we did have a lot of repeat stuff.
We're getting a lot of Raw.
Actually, right. That, now that I think about it, the proportion of it is really off.
Mm-hmm.
The only SmackDown matches I can think. Yeah. Okay, so I think there's three SmackDown matches. There's the main title match, the women's tag, and
AJ.
And AJ.
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe there's more that I think of, but yeah.
Yeah, if you think that that women's tag match is going to be on the main show.
Yeah, I don't know what they're going to do.
Did they announce a pre-show match for SmackDown?
They didn't.
Did they announce Baron versus Kalisto? Because if they didn't, guess what's going to be on that pre-show?
Yes.
Oh, that pre-show.
Maybe we'll have a Heath Slater match.
Yeah. And like this, don't get me wrong. I'm interested in SummerSlam. There's matches on the night. Like, we're getting the first of a Cesaro Sheamus best of seven series.
Oh, which can is we great. Talk about this? No.
Which is great, but it should be on SmackDown.
Man, it's
going to
be
No. All right, hold on. I wasn't on the wrap-up last night. I need to talk about this. This is not great.
Okay.
This is not making Raw great again. First of all, we've already had two matches with them.
Mm-hmm.
Cesaro wins clean. Secondly, what is this series for? There's no answer because it's for nothing. If this was for like a US title shot, underwhelming, but okay. If this was for a Universal Championship shot at the first Raw only pay-per-view, fine. I'm invested in that. That's great. That pushes both of these guys to try and beat each other's asses. If it's for nothing, but, oh, you kicked me in the head once. The fuck?
To give them the benefit of the doubt, they may say that at the end or something. They may say, you impressed us.
Can you name me another best of series that wasn't for anything? Even the Terry Invitational Tournament was for Terry's managerial services and a big sack of money with a dollar sign on it, for Christ's sake.
You're right. And they did, to credit to the angle, they did state that it was because they have this one-upmanship between each other.
But it's not one-upmanship. Cesaro won the two matches. Yeah, he's already two ahead.
I'm interested in the actual matches because I think those two guys work well together. But I do agree that the setup is a little weird just because the setup doesn't really fit in the sense of a best of seven, because a best of seven, like Mike mentioned, should be more about like the fact that they're two competitive people. Like that's what happened with Benoit and Booker T. That's what happened with, you know, even
or
with
the U.S. title, by the way.
Yeah. Or the TV title in WCW.
Yeah.
If
they did this where there's a different stipulation on each match, even if it's for nothing, that gets me slightly more interested. But if it's all just one-on-one matches, that is just stagnant booking. That's literally just taking the blackboard they have in Gorilla, writing something in Sharpie, and just not having to erase it for a couple months.
Well, and here's the thing. It was already...
That's not entertaining.
It was already noticeable that we were getting an extended Sheamus and Cesaro match again this week.
But in fairness, at least they put something to it, because guess what? We've had WWE does a lot of series. They just don't call them that because they just put the same matches out a lot of the time. Like, you know what I mean? Like, at least they're calling it something, and at least they're trying to sound something. I get your complaints with it, but like, you know what I mean? At least there's something.
Okay, but the setup to this was done wrong because Cesaro won both the matches that they had.
No, I understand.
If Sheamus cheated to win one and Cesaro won the other one clean.
But it's not just the matches. It's not just the matches. It's also the interference and the getting in the way of the U.S. title match that Cesaro had too. So it isn't.
Okay,
it's not just
Cesaro what he's looking for.
It's not just about the wins.
Okay, but it was about the U.S. title. And now it's about nothing. Even if Cesaro sweeps this series, what does that do for him? Because Sheamus can just as easily kick him in the head again.
We move on because writing will do that. From the chat room, another apparent, I'm guessing he's saying this is in our best of seven series, not for anything, was ACH versus Matt Sydal.
That's true. But so. I understand Mike's points. I just, again, my appeal to that is just based off of their in-ring chemistry.
ACH and Sydal were also a tag team. That's a competition amongst tag team partners. I understand that because Rey Mysterio and Eddie Guerrero had virtually the same thing. Mm-hmm. And that's fine. That's trying to see who's the Shawn and who's the Marty.
Right.
But this is for nothing.
Mike, I think all this is going to be a moot in the long run because I have some bad news. That's going to just ruin your weekend and maybe shorten that line of tickets that you have in hand there because the Flow Rider concert has been canceled.
No!
How is Slater going to get his revenge now?
I apologize to all the audio listeners.
Bobby of G-Town pointed it out, and yeah, it has been canceled. I pulled it up on Ticketmaster even, and it's marked as canceled.
Wow.
So yeah,
Can we talk about another thing with SummerSlam? Sorry, I'm just totally dismissing this Flow Rider major news. Can we talk about something else with SummerSlam that was like kind of almost brushed under the rug, but probably shouldn't have been on Raw?
What's that?
That Jon Stewart's coming back.
Yeah, if Jon Stewart dresses as Demon Balor,
I'm thinking because what are they going to do? Because they've got to do something based off of last year.
Well, clearly, Eamon, he's going to interact with the celebrity that SmackDown is bringing, right?
I thought
SmackDown's not bringing anyone.
Maybe it's Flow.
Because the shows aren't equal. This is a Raw pay-per-view. This is not a Raw pay-per-view. Saying Wonder Woman's in Batman versus Superman.
What?
No.
Wow, I got what you did there, Mike. Wonder Woman is
SmackDown. Wonder Woman is SmackDown. It's not about her. It's about the other guys.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Look at aggregate screen time compared to aggregate match time. That's what it is.
Yet was still.
And to be fair, Wonder Woman may have the best moments of the card. Cena versus AJ is going to be great. I'm sure Randy will do something fun. and Dolph might actually like get hit by Doomsday and just smile and super kick him. I don't know. Something could happen. But it ain't about Wonder Woman. It's about Batman versus Superman. And that will probably be as underwhelming because, as you all know, Seth Rollins and Finn Balor, their mothers are of the same name.
Wait a minute. So does that mean...
I'm confused.
They're going after the DC Universal Heavyweight Championship.
Yes. Yes.
Yep.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That's it.
I see where you went there, Mike.
Yes.
I like it.
Thank you.
So SummerSlam.
I'm still on this. I'm still working on this. I'm trying to figure out who Lex Luger is or Luthor is. Lex Luthor is Lex Luger. Let's just go with that.
Yeah, Lex Luger makes his return.
on the Lex Express, baby.
SmackDown just keeps bringing in these old wrestlers. They're bringing back Rhino, Kurt Hawkins, Lex Luger. He can't wrestle. We'll bring him back anyways.
No, you know who Lex Luthor is? Paul Heyman, because he's releasing a monster.
I was thinking that, yeah.
I like it. All right. Well, we're going to get into the...
By the way, this does mean Randy Orton is Wonder Woman. That does mean that.
Ouch.
But John Cena is Wonder Woman.
Because you know where Wonder Woman came from? Out of nowhere!
Wow.
And on that note, we're going to move the fuck on. Wow. Okay.
that made me angry.
You know what's great and can't be compared to really bad DC Comics movies? Indie wrestling, I hope. And we are celebrating this week 1 year. 1 year of IndieWrestling.us, the one-stop shop to find many friends of the show. Digital downloads, DVDs for our friends with the Renegade Wrestling Alliance. You can probably catch some glimpses of Wheels in there, as well as the International Wrestling Cartel, our friends with Vicious Outcast Wrestling, Prime Wrestling stuff, You know, some great classic moments there. Documentaries with Joe Dombrowski, including the Montreal Theory and Virgil on his traveling merchandise table. If you want this stuff, if you want a discount, 50% off for the next week with the coupon code 1 year. The number 1 and year, all caps.
1 year.
50% off any digital download, as well as $5 off any DVD. We almost never have sales on our DVDs. Now we do. So go check it out. IndieWrestling.us, the great column around the indies by our friend in the mainstream media, Matt Carlins. And it's a great resource. We also have 605 Wrestling. We also have Border City Wrestling. And more to come. More to come to Indie Wrestling.
I've been to Border City Wrestling.
That's US. Pretty cool. Border City Wrestling. That's in Canada, isn't it?
The one I went to was kind of close to Canada. It was in the Detroit, border.
It was across the Border City Wrestling. There you go. Mm-hmm. There you go. So go check that out and so much more at indiewrestling.us. Sign up for the newsletter to get details on sales and new releases as they come out, as well as updates on Wrestling Mayhem Show from week to week. Go check it out, indiewrestling.us. Guys, speaking of indie wrestling, we know a lot of guys that are on NXT TakeOver anymore, don't we? NXT TakeOver Brooklyn 2. My least favorite logo of the takeovers.
Yeah. Yeah, it is what it is.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Mike, you're used to this. Your proximity, like, this is the style with the chain and everything. I just feel like
JTG showing up, Sork.
If only.
We're bringing the hood to you.
We're bringing
it. I would like to see the prime time players versus crime time.
Oh.
No. See, what they're not saying is that JTG is going to show up on SummerSlam and team with Titus O'Neil so they can be called the crime time players.
Let's go. What's happened on TakeOver?
Man, the dream matches that nobody wanted this weekend at the Barclays Center. Okay, TakeOver. There's a lot of stuff happening at TakeOver. We got, let's see. Wait. Let me double check. Okay, we don't have the Nakamura haters on this week. But Nakamura.
Wait, we had Nakamura haters?
The Hooven week?
Oh, yeah. Okay,
never mind. Hooven week? Yeah. No. Yeah.
I understand Hooven points. Yeah.
I don't. He just has no joy in his life.
He's just sad because the Ryback's gone.
Yeah. Ryback.
Don't worry. He can watch TNA real soon.
Oh boy.
Hashtag Ryborg.
NXT TakeOver. I don't know what to say about it.
It looks good.
I'm still on the Ryback.
I'm so excited, Sorg.
Oh, of course you are. You're going to be there again.
Yeah, we're going to get to see a friend of the show win the tag titles. Or something horrible is going to happen to a friend of the show.
No.
A friend of the show is going to happen.
That's Monday Night Raw against Nia Jax every week, apparently. Side note, friend of the show, Delilah Doom this week.
So Nia Jax is just systematically going through every woman you've had on the Indie Mayhem show.
I see how it is, Nia.
Note to self. Sorg, stop booking women on the shows.
Well, Raylan hasn't popped up yet, so it's not yet. Seriously, if they swing back up this way and Raylan pops up on that, it's just that they're watching. Who else have we talked to? Hey, Barbie Hayden will pop up, or Angela Lane, I think we talked to. They'll just go down the line.
That's gonna keep happening.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's gonna keep happening.
Anyways, takeover.
Arya Stark's list.
And Game of Thrones reference for you guys that don't watch that. Anyways, TakeOver, I think, is I don't feel like it's as crazy as the build has been last year. But I don't know. Bailey, Asuka? Damn it.
Asuka?
Yeah. Asuka. I'm going to have to
Good
write
job,
this down. Folk. I'm going to write this down. Talk about it. I'm going to write this down.
Asuka.
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 How do I even write that down so I remember it?
Well, I mean, you can also say Asuka, but that's just how William Regal says it.
Well, there you go. There you go. Like, because
yeah. What am I going to ask
her? As I think Zora was saying, yeah, that match has been built great. I don't know. Yeah, you can compare it to last year's TakeOver, but I even, you know, the matches I think are still really solid, and I'm excited for a great deal of them. Like, you know, even like Joe and Nakamura, for the little build that it's had, it's still going to be really good. The tag title match, as we alluded to, I think is going to be really great. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff on here that I'm excited about.
I got a point.
And plus, we're getting to see a couple debuts for NXT, too. Like, right. Bobby Roode's going to have his first match. Ember Moon is going to have her first match.
All right,
I'm really excited.
Two things. First of all, on that build to Nakamura and Joe, one, I don't think it needs much other than we're badass, we're going to fight each other. Two, Got Your Nose is the best freaking build
I've ever
seen.
Is the greatest thing. Like, it only would have been better if he did, like, the gesture like you do to a little kid. Like,
yeah.
He did this and just waved it at Joe. That would have been the best thing in the world.
Amazing.
He still could do it on Sunday, I guess. But, yeah, the ender for that, like, for that go-home was amazing. Because I think Wednesday is literally just a preview.
Wednesday, we get, I think it's a preview, and then we get like one, it's a 6-woman tag featuring the two women that drafted the SmackDown and four of the rookie girls.
Oh, okay. Should be interesting.
Okay. By the way, all the rookie girls keep popping up in my tops slam decks so far. I played it a whole 2 days. Yeah. Welcome to my new addiction. Thanks, guys. As if Pokemon Go wasn't pointless enough. Thank you. But anyways,
just wait till they have WWE Go, Sork.
Well, let's so.
Oh my.
Oh.
It's gonna be a thing.
Gotta catch the Slaters.
Cool.
Gotta catch the Slaters. Eamon, I was excited when you dropped a hint about Ember Moon a few weeks
ago.
And you ignored my message when I said, "Who do you think it is?" I wanted to know who you thought it was.
Because I actually kind of knew who it was.
Well, yeah, of course you do.
Eamon knows who it is.
Of course you do. And I should have known. But they finally showed her this week. And I pretty much figured it out, I think. I did. Athena was her name, right?
Yes. It'll be very exciting. This is the equivalency of your Logan Shula making a debut. Not, you know, maybe in reaction. But from a reaction on the show, like this is somebody who I've gotten to work with, so I'm very excited to be able to, you know, tell people that, hey, she's going to be awesome, and you're going to really enjoy her.
If I'm not mistaken, I think, Wheels, you and I both saw her at AIW's Absolution last year.
Yeah, you and I got to see her there, and I've actually got to work with her at IWWA down in West Virginia. Got to know her, and she was pretty cool down there. So I'm really happy that she's going to get her debut and everything. So all three of us are excited for this.
Badass. I think she fought Veda Scott up at Absolution last year.
Yep.
It was a badass women's match. So
yes.
So looking forward to see what she does in that mix with Asuka and
Yay!
The rest of them. So really, really looking forward to that. And curious what they're going to do with her persona with this as well. Very, very mysterious. And what was the other debut coming up?
Well, we got Bobby Roode.
Bobby Roode's first match.
That's right. Bobby Roode, who, one, has been fantastic, I thought, in his build to this, because he's Bobby Roode. Also, whether Full Sail will play along with it or not. Also, Bobby Roode... Glorious Bombs with Ciampa and Gargano is my favorite thing on the internet right now.
I'm enjoying those.
I mean, just building the most the stupidest entrance music I probably heard for a while and making it the best thing ever. That I might pick it up on iTunes. Perfect. Absolutely amazing. And just like wrapping your head around, like, Gargano is hanging out with Bobby Roode, and the psycho Tommaso Ciampa that was in RWA, and this, like my brain breaks at it. You guys might remember like that. Wait, the NWO is completely in the WWE. This isn't a thing that's supposed to happen, right? Like that's how I feel about this combination of people of awesomeness on the internet and on NXT.
Or Shane McMahon just walking out on Nitro.
Yeah.
Or you know what it is? Hmm. It's glorious. Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I love that NXT is turning into all the good parts of Impact Wrestling that were left, and except for Ethan Carter. I almost call him Derek Bateman. But
we might as well at this point.
That is true.
Anyways, we might as well.
I hope so. I tagged you, Mike, that he's going to be in Queens on Friday. So while you're going to miss out on your Flow Rider, you can go check out some Ethan Carter up in Queens.
If I wasn't slinging some toys, I would probably go for that.
Priorities. I get it, Mike. Other than that, I say Samoa Joe Nakamura, we mentioned here briefly, but I think it's going to be a tremendous match. It's going to be a hard-hitting match.
I'm also super excited for Austin Aries and No Way Jose.
Yeah, that's going to be fun. That's
like
if you told me that
match was happening before they were building up to it, I would have been like, that's weird. Okay. But no, I'm excited for that match. I think it's going to be really good.
I would imagine we're probably going to get not on TakeOver, but the week after. TM61 versus the Authors of Pain.
Yeah, that's what it looks like.
Yeah.
I would imagine that's probably going to be on there.
No Way Jose, I think they did the right thing where they didn't let him be the weird joke Fandango thing for too long, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like they're like, oh yeah, he's a good fun guy, and then it's like, and we turn the switch, right? So now he can flip back and forth instead of it being weird, you know. Like
he's
fixed
Adam Rose.
Because they tried to do it far too late after he was doing Mike's Hard Lemonade commercials, right? And and brought him up the Raw way too soon. Again, we've been saying about some of these people, like maybe Dana Brooke or maybe some of these other girls that have come up. He needs to bake a little more in NXT before he came up. Also, apparently, not be an asshole and have domestic issues. That probably also led to it too.
They need to send Ascension back down there too.
Do you think?
Yeah.
I think
they're fine.
There's not much they can, especially now with the Authors of Pain down there. There's not much Ascension will be able to do.
I can see them returning and kind of do a rebuild. But I mean, Ascension walks in there. Ascension did a match with whoever the tag team champions were at the time, and it was just like the good old days.
I think it was Vaudevillains.
Probably Vaudevillains, yeah. And so the crowd is behind them there, but I think they have to work around.
They never translate.
No,
it
they
never
did.
Yeah.
They never did. It didn't work on that stage, and I don't know. I don't think it's their fault.
Well, you have to remember, the Ascension was tag champs for NXT for almost a year. And they never had real competition. They always faced off against jobber teams.
Well, also because there weren't any tag teams really at the time. Like if the Ascension kind of came in around now in NXT, like I think they would have been much better off because they could do more. Like, you know, it just was unfortunate that when they were in NXT, it was a time where they were really trying to make something of the tag division with, you know, something that they had. They didn't have American Alpha. They didn't have,
Even have Blake and Murphy.
Yeah, they didn't even have Blake and Murphy. They had guys like Nick Bros. They didn't have guys like Nick Bros or any of those guys. It was them and then, like, Kalisto getting a random tag partner every once in a while until they found Sinclair.
Yeah, so maybe now that they're in a division that has a lot of tag teams, aka Wonder Woman show, I mean SmackDown Live, they'll do a little better. Sorry, Mike.
It's fine.
There's a lot of them that can benefit from time there. So either way, TakeOver looking pretty good.
And by the way, if you want our predictions for TakeOver, Eamon and I are going to do a full rundown of the midweek war this week.
There you go.
Yes, indeed.
Of course. So maybe we'll have a couple of us pop in there if I'm free that night.
Yeah. So, or you can email in.
Or
you can email in your predictions at goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com. Because We'll read them on the air, I promise.
All right, with that, hey, let's give a shout out to our good friends at Slice on Broadway here in Pittsburgh. I know that's very localized to our Mayhem Universal, to the Mayhem Universe. Oh, that feels gross just saying that.
The Mayhem Galaxy.
The Mayhem Galaxy?
Yeah, we're the first Galacticast.
Wasn't that Space Ghost? Who's got the train? Who's rolling by the train?
That's the Ho train.
We just figured out that Aim is by the train track. So
It's my fault.
I'm trying to give a plug here to our friends at Slice on Broadway here in Beachview along the tracks, as well as their other locations in Carnegie, PA on the Main Street, as well as PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Hi, Colt. Go check them out. Some friends of the show that have been supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza for a good while now. Great friends of the community of the show of podcasting. And please check them out. SliceOnBroadway.com. PGH_Slice on the Twitter. Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and the Instagrams. Let them know you heard about them on the Mayhem Show. Suggest pro wrestling shapes for their pieces that they can make.
Ooh, Sorg, they can do a square pizza that looks like a wrestling ring.
And I bet they can. These people are dough artists. A Hello Kitty dough doll is a thing they made, and it's amazing. So,
ooh, maybe they can make a championship belt out of pizza. Ooh,
there you go.
What? The Raw title should be just the pizza championship. It should just be the pizza championship.
We're going to check in with some friends and some other shows you should check out, and we'll be right back with a big question. Let's talk tech. Tech news discussions from the people in the industry right here in Pittsburgh. Online, gadgets, startups, and more. Check it out at awesomecast.net. Wrestling Mayhem Show got the crew here, of course. Hot Wheels, RWA Sound Dude in California, Pennsylvania. Mad Mike from up in Poughkeepsie, New York, and Eamon from somewhere in Texas.
That if you've listened carefully enough to the entire show, you'd be able to figure it out.
Follow the clues. Follow the clues, boppers.
And if you need help, call Scooby-Doo.
Anyway, so the news was dropped that, No Mercy is a great name for our new pay-per-view coming up. We already heard that Backlash.
So inventive.
Such a new, innovative name. Okay.
At least I didn't call it No Fear.
Yeah. Oh.
Cero miedo.
At least hasn't been a tap-out pay-per-view. Anyways... That would be a good name for like an all submission pay per view.
Well, they're sponsored by Tap Out, so
yeah. WWE Tap Out, the show. But anyways,
every match is a submission match.
Yeah. But anyways, so that Backlash is coming back. Roadblock is going to be a pay per view. It's not officially on the site, but it's been announced as a show for us in Pittsburgh here. And there's a list of retired pay-per-views they still have listed here. Were we doing this on the show where we were playing around with what shows they should bring back? I think we did that as a goal a few weeks ago, right? But seriously, what shows should they bring back? That's the big question this week. What are the retired pay-per-views over the years would you like to see return as a Raw or SmackDown pay-per-view? I don't know if you want to disclose which one you want to bring them back as?
Sure.
If you want to. It's not required. Mike, I know you said you already had an answer when we were talking about this on the break. So what show should WWE certainly bring back?
That would be the King of the Ring.
Ooh.
The real deal King of the Ring.
The tournament all the way.
Yes. Yeah. Well, not the tournament all the way. You don't need to do the tournament all the way. You can have the prelims on Raw and SmackDown. You can have that. But The whole appeal of the King of the Ring tournament was the winner needed to wrestle three times. That was the whole appeal of it. Like, that is what made it such a daunting tournament.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, like, that's what should be brought back. They shouldn't do it as a network exclusive type of thing. They should just do it as a full-fledged pay-per-view. And you can actually have it be Raw versus SmackDown, guys, which would be really cool.
And you also shouldn't you also don't have to have them become a king character afterwards.
No.
Right.
Because if you notice, the ones that have really succeeded from the King of the Ring are the ones that didn't automatically become king something.
I will counter. King Booker was...
Yeah, but there were only two people who actually took the king gimmick and rolled with it.
Uh-huh.
Three that were successful. One of them not so successful, but King Mabel, King Owen Hart, King Booker. Those were the only ones that were successful. Edge never did the king thing.
What?
Triple H never did the king thing. Austin never did the king thing.
Brock never did.
Angle never
did. Well, can I roll back? Because here's a little known thing about King of the Ring. There were King of the Ring tournaments before there was a pay-per-view.
Yes.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That was actually in one of the trivia questions I won at the bar last night.
Right. And wasn't King Harley Race a king off of that?
Yes.
I think so.
So was the Macho King.
But the King Owen, and because I don't know this because I'm bad at history, so was King Owen Hart like literally coming out with like a crown and scepter every week after? Okay.
For a while.
He had his light show changed to a playing card with him posing as being the King of Hearts.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Oh, because I know he referred to himself as that. I just didn't know if he was like
being... Oh yeah, no. He went full board.
Because when you like the recent ones were like Sheamus, Barrett, like they actually became king characters, and they never worked out. It's much better than just having them win and then establish them as like, oh, you're now a top guy. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, because the king gimmick shackles you, and unless you're ready to fully commit to that, and I'm not only talking to the performer, but the writers, mm-hmm. they have to fully commit to that, like they did with King Booker. And it's lucky that I think the King's Speech was around that time. If that movie wasn't a thing at the same time, King Booker would have died.
I thought King's Speech was like...
I might be mistaken in my time. There was something that he pulled from that was popular in current pop
culture. Because he actually did something with the character other than I'm the main character, but I'm just gonna wear a crown constantly. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but he changed his accent, he changed his mannerisms. Right. There was something I don't remember what it was at the time. I thought it was the King's Speech, but it was something that he pulled from that worked.
Yeah, you actually have to do something with the gimmick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I want the King of the Ring back. That's me.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. What about you, Wheels?
I was thinking about it, and I went, I'm going to go into, strange enough, one of the companies they bought, WCW, and give it maybe to either SmackDown or Raw. I haven't decided yet. Giving it Bash at the Beach as their SummerSlam.
Yes.
Bash at the Beach would be an awesome return for one of them to have as their SummerSlam.
Can I also say this is also important to note that I think also with a lot of these ones that we're naming as well, WWE also has to change the mentality when it comes to the set designs.
Yeah.
Just in general.
Because I like these are great ideas. It's just, but if we do those ideas with like their generic set piece that they're using for every pay per view, like,
I get it. New stages are hard to design. They're expensive.
Yeah, but
they make your pay per view feel special. That's one of the main reasons WrestleMania feels special is because they have a whole, like, they do a whole Periscope thing. Like, here's what the stage looks like for WrestleMania this year. That's because it's the only pay-per-view where you change that now. Like, that's why Cruiserweight Classic feels so different. It's stage different.
Right.
And like they use the old FCW stage. They don't use the NXT stage.
But like also for pay per views that are like Bash at the Beach, like you, it's not the same if you don't have that beach kind of setting that's like infamous with that show. Like, my favorite King of the Ring stuff was when they had that big chair like that was for the entrance. Like I thought that was amazing. Like you kind of need that kind of stuff to kind of make those pay per views feel like pay per views.
Yeah, I agree.
All right, what about you, Amy?
They need beach balls. They need sand. They need the women's wrestling. No, never mind. I was going to say have the women's wrestling.
Whatever you say about WCW, they were always really good with that.
Yeah.
They were always really good with that.
That's because Slim Jim usually sponsored those.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and like I think like not just how like Halloween had it, but like Spring Stampede where they would have like those rickety like you know carts and stuff like that and just hay bales and shit stuff like that's like you know
Even Road Wild was really cool.
Well, I was going to say because you got me thinking about it. I kind of want Road Wild Hog Wild to be a thing again.
That would be
like
awesome.
I think that's mine. I'd love them to say, hey, we're going to do cross promotion with Sturgis. It's a great fan base, you know. I mean, Vince is a Harley guy.
Yes, but that pay per view lost them a lot of money.
Yeah, well, yes. I'm not going to be a businessman in my decision. That's the one that I thought was cool. Watching a couple of luchadors wrestle in front of a bunch of bikers revving their engines was the most surreal and amazing thing to watch with my dad. So
and Sorg, added bonus. That's how you debut Son of Havoc in WWE.
There you go. There you go. Riding bitch as usual. Amen. Which one would you pick?
There's nothing like a group full of motorcycle raveling North Dakotians being super racist towards Harlem Heat.
Yeah.
Hashtag Trump 2016.
Yes.
Oh, there we go. Good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Amen. What would you pick? Please move on.
If it wasn't already coming back, my pick would have been Backlash. Solely because of the hook theme set, because that's one of my favorite sets.
Didn't somebody swing off of that joke one year?
The Jacob Goodnight theme set.
Yeah, basically.
who climbed on that and like rode it like as it swung?
Jeff Hardy.
Jeff Hardy.
Well, Jeff. I'm sorry, it was Brother Nero.
Well, yeah, Jeff did once. I think Shane did once as well. It's something. People tend to use a lot. I'm going to say, if only based off of the theme that they had it one time for this pay-per-view, I'm going to say Fully Loaded, the Dice theme pay-per-view that they had.
Yes, that was good. That was good. Can I also throw in a secondary one, Sorg? Hmm. All right, and I want them to go back to the original concept of Tribute for the Troops.
Okay.
Like having it outside at a military barracks. It doesn't have it doesn't have to be overseas. I get that. I understand why it's not.
I love that they even whitewash their Tribute to the Troops show now.
Like it's just this. It's just it. Like you can tell it's taking place before a SmackDown taping.
Like come on, guys. Like really.
Like you can have it at an outdoor. Like, make it like a USO show. Have it for actual troops. Not just like, oh, here's a... Because that doesn't feel like a tribute to the troops to me.
No,
I was
going to
say, that's not a tribute. That's like, okay, we got to throw this together. Let's get the local Army, Navy, and all these guys in here and
it's not an arena full of military people.
Yeah.
Like, it's just an arena and there's military people around, but like,
yeah,
it's not full of them.
I mean, that's a big thing because they did it outdoors because they had to, right?
Well, they did it because we had a lot more troops stationed, and when we started pulling troops out, that's when they stopped going over there and having the full show.
Right.
I understand that aspect of it, but there are still plenty of military bases in the United States that have venues where you can do this.
Right.
Like the reason the Tribute to the Troops felt so cool was because it was a smaller, intimate show, and you could see everyone in their military uniforms enjoying the hell out of the show.
Right.
Yes.
Like, now it's just like, you see fucking Frank the Clown there. Like, oh, really? What branch of the military did you serve in, Frank? Come on.
I have a feeling we're going to have a lot to say about Frank the Clown after next week.
Certainly are, Sorg.
Did anybody watch the first look last
night?
No. Okay.
When I start watching it, I'm going to count how many times I'm reminded of Brooke Hogan, though.
How do you mean?
No, because that's what Noel Foley's going to become. Oh, you watch.
No. I hope not.
You watch. No. It's going to happen.
I hope Mick's better than that.
It's going to happen.
Mick's smarter
than that. It's just in how they're going to be used. That's it. Do you remember Brooke Hogan in TNA? I'm not talking about Hogan's No Best. I'm not talking about that.
I was going to say, I don't remember shit about that, and I'm thankful.
No, that's when Bully Ray seduced Brooke Hogan when he was in Aces and Eights. Oh, it's going to be a whole thing, you guys.
Oh, but in fairness, if Rusev does that, because they teased the whole Rusev stuff, like, that could be great.
What?
Because they did the stuff on Raw with, like, Rusev getting mad at McFoley and stuff like that.
I'm pretty sure the guy who just had a wedding celebration is not going to be seducing a 19-year-old.
No, it doesn't have to be seducing. Like, he can, like, kick her or something. I don't know.
He can kick her.
What? You want Raw to be different?
Well, then.
That would certainly work.
Mm-hmm.
Oh! Hashtag Kane Noel. What?
Okay. Well, there's that. We'll talk about that, I'm sure, next week.
Hashtag Women's Revolution.
Eamon?
Sword.
What's the deal with Texas fans?
Oh, some of them are really bad.
So, there's been, like, odd nights on Raw, right? And some things where, you know, that would have been great if the fans didn't kind of crap on it, and they really probably shouldn't have. But what? Corpus Christi, huh?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It became a thing. Not often are people, like, a town is trashed because of their fandom, since the Pittsburgh Royal Rumble and the Philadelphia Royal Rumble.
I don't think you guys were trashed, really.
No. Well, we were very vocal. But anyways, I mean, this is the other side. This isn't like post day after WrestleMania Raw or anything like that. This is like kind of the other end. Why is Corpus Christi so sad?
Because they don't get anything. Because it's Corpus Christi. They don't get any shit. I'm shocked Raw's even in Corpus.
Eamon, you got Elimination Chamber. Granted, you weren't able to enjoy that, but you got Elimination Chamber.
And I will say, other than one match on that show, it's not a great show.
But still, it's an Elimination Chamber. Like, it was a network.
And again, show. I was surprised when they got that, because normally if you get a tape show for Corpus Christi, you get, like, a SmackDown.
Right.
Like, the last show I remember going to in that building, I think Mayhem was CM Punk versus Fandango. And that gives you, like, a gist of, like, what kind of shows they get. Like, it's not anything special. And the crowd is that weird, like, they're not the vocal crowd. They're the "we'll take what you're giving us" crowd. You know what I mean?
And if we're bored, we'll just jump out of the crowd.
Well, yeah. But, like, they're the crowd that's like, oh, you want us to like Roman Reigns? We'll care for Roman Reigns. Like, they're the good abiding citizens, because it's very much like a, you know, not as smart kind of crowd. You know, it's, you know, and in fairness, I don't think they really – it sucks, because that's the place where they fucking did the first main roster Balor entrance, and I don't think that should have been the place to do it.
No.
Like, because they don't care. Like, in fairness, they don't care. Like, they weren't even that, like, hot for, like, Enzo and Cass and stuff. Like, yeah, it's just off-putting, because it's, like, that's not the crowd that cares about those kind of guys. And now, the way WWE's roster is, a lot of those guys are, like, those kind of guys. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I mean, credit to them when you mentioned it. Like, they were good for this women's thing. But, like, other than that, like, they're just not the right crowd. They're not the right crowd to have, you know, certain things at.
And in contrast, the reaction for the beginning of John Cena and Alberto Del Rio tonight was the hottest reaction I think I've ever heard on a SmackDown.
Which is so weird.
Yeah.
For Austin.
Yeah.
Because Austin's the smart crowd.
Right. Right. And tonight, they were in for John Cena. It was crazy. Crazy. You had no idea that he was fighting a guy that's not even on SummerSlam, except that it was mentioned in the segment before. Incredible. And they had a really good match, to be fair. They had an incredible match, actually, for that main event. Like I say, all together, I felt like SmackDown had a better vibe tonight than it usually does. So we've had this conversation before about bad fans and bad crowds as well. I just thought it kind of really...
And people shit on vocal crowds. I've heard a lot of people, fans and wrestlers, shit on like NXT crowds for being too vocal and stuff like that. But I think that's a testament to, like, I would rather have a way too vocal crowd than a way too silent crowd.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
I mean, just sort of you and I have had this discussion of a lot of wrestlers, even in this area, they've told me, and I hate that damn train, and that they love how the RWA crowd
and the train took out his
compared to other crowd on the hands.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, they're like, wow. So, I mean, yeah, I agree with Eamon on, like, some people would argue, oh, I don't want too much of a vocal crowd. I'm sorry, I'd rather have a crowd into something than dead.
See, it depends on what, because we say that.
If you're a wrestler, yes. I think I.
Oh, yeah, if you're a wrestler, absolutely. But see, as people watching it, sometimes I'm okay if the crowd shuts up a little bit. Because you watch some episodes of NXT, that crowd never shuts up.
No, I disagree. Because those crowds where it's like, if that's the fourth episode they're taping and they're dead.
Yeah, but that's one every four episodes.
But those shows aren't as good. And they personally take me out of it. They take me out of it more when the crowd's dead than they do if they're, you know, being a little more vocal than usual. Like, I would prefer, I don't know, I'm the kind of guy where I need crowd reaction. I need people to be excited about this because it carries my excitement into it. You know what right. I mean? Mm-hmm. I get your point, and I understand people's complaints with, like, smart crowds or whatever, but guess what? That's going to be – if you're a wrestler complaining about, like, smart crowds and stuff like that, like, sorry, like, if you want to make it big, that's the crowds you're going to be appealing to nowadays. That's crowds who are going to – you know, that's just how the audience of wrestling's changed. Like,
those are the crowds mm-hmm. that are going to champion you and tell their friends about you. If you're nice to them,
they'll champion the hell out of you.
Those are the crowds. Those are the crowds that tell all their friends about. You got to see this guy Prince Devitt. You got to see this guy Prince Nakamura. Oh man, you got to see what Kevin this is Owens. About. You got to see, like, this guy, like, Kevin
really
Steen.
Do you really think Kevin Owens, as much as I like him and as much as he's talented, it's his reputation that got him where he is.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? He built a reputation for himself. He became the fan favorite. He became the one that everyone loved and everyone thought was the best. And that's what got him his position.
Certainly. Certainly. Well, that's good. Wow, we got a good conversation out of just trashing Texas. I love it.
Anytime, Sorg. Anytime.
Sorg, I mean, honestly, I think we've had this discussion even when we've praised how great Pittsburgh did the last Raw. I mean, mm-hmm. we've always had good discussions about crowds because we're fans still, so we're going to be vocal on what we feel is right and what's wrong. So
certainly.
Not everybody. It's not trashing Texas per se. It's just some cities do suck.
No. We're trashing.
By the way, I apologize in advance for how Brooklyn's probably going to be.
Well,
no, Brooklyn was great.
I know. Like, I have a feeling. I have a feeling about SummerSlam. I just have a feeling. I have a feeling a lot of that stuff at SummerSlam is going to go over like a wet fart in church.
Okay. SummerSlam's different. SummerSlam's different.
I'm not concerned about Takeover. Takeover is going to be great. I'm concerned about the fan reaction at SummerSlam. I have a feeling during Sheamus and Cesaro, we're going to get JBL chants. I have a feeling during that six woman tag, we're going to get, we want Sasha chance, or hey, we want some Bailey. I just have a feeling that it's not going to be as good.
If you're going to chant "We want Sasha" during that six woman tag, you're getting her later in the show. Shut the fuck up! Like,
I want to point out that that crowd will.
Wait a second.
I want to point out that that crowd will also be exposed to at least 5 hours of wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. I want to point out that it shouldn't matter.
I think it's. I think
it matters. I've been to super long shows like that. You guys have been to super long shows like
Can
that.
Can I? Okay.
There, if you're draining. Tired, if you're tired, don't chant something that's stupid and doesn't help the match. Mm-hmm. Just watch the match. Rest. Rest your vocal cords.
Okay.
Watch and enjoy the program.
I'm not. Like, I'm not going to get into my disagreement with your philosophy there. What I will do is, because remember how SummerSlam felt last year, right? We do, like, after we watched that takeover and we're like, that is the best thing I've ever watched. Good luck, SummerSlam. And then we had SummerSlam and we're like, well, that was SummerSlam. I want to point out. So this is what SummerSlam looked like last year. Okay.
I was going to bring this up if you didn't.
Oh, good. Oh, good.
Yeah. Because I was talking about this with my at work tonight.
Of course, the main event was Undertaker and Brock Lesnar. Okay. Which that's exciting, right? It's a definitely a rematch from WrestleMania, which I believe had a pretty screwy finish as well.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
that was the weird Charles Robinson.
Right.
The bell ringer thought he tapped, but he didn't. Like, thank
you. Mm-hmm.
High points were Seth Rollins and John Cena, where Jon Stewart got involved.
Screwy finish.
The three-way
was really good and unexpected.
The three-way nine-woman tag that was the start of the Divas Revolution.
Kinda.
Roman Reigns and Ambrose versus the Wyatt family. Wyatt and Harper. Okay.
Oh God!
All right. I don't think that was a great match that I recall. Ryback and the Big Show and the Miz. For the Intercontinental Championship. Now this
wow,
one. Now
this year is looking great.
Stephen Amell and Neville against Stardust and King Barrett. That was fun.
That was still probably my favorite match.
That was fun. Dolph Ziggler with Lana against Rusev with Summer Rae.
Yeah.
All right. New Day.
Let's forget that feud happened.
Boy, they've all really progressed, haven't they?
New Day.
Mm-hmm.
New Day. I think this is when they won their championship for their current run. Defeated the then champion, the Primetime Players. This was referenced actually this week on Raw. Lucha Dragons and Los Matadores with El Torito.
I have to think that the last champions before the current champions were the Primetime Players.
Yep, wrap your head around one. And, of course, in the opening match of the evening, Sheamus defeated Randy Orton.
Holy fuck.
Wait, didn't Kevin Owens have a match with Cesaro in that show, too?
He did.
Oh, yeah.
I skipped it. Sorry about that. Yeah, he did. Yep.
Okay. Because I was going to say, I know there was one match I really enjoyed on SummerSlam that didn't have Stephen Amell in it.
Oh, God, I just realized, what if Jon Stewart interferes in AJ and John Cena's match?
He might.
Yeah.
Jon Stewart may be SummerSlam's Pete Rose. I had that thought today when they announced that.
I'd be okay with that.
Yeah. And every time Seth Rollins kept yelling for Demon King, in my head, God. I kept hearing Demon Kane.
Yep, every single time. They need to stop calling him the Demon King.
Well, that's the thing. The backstage segment, I thought, like, when he's walking through that hallway, I thought he saw someone and said, Demon Kane. Like, he was about to talk to Kane or someone.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. I kind of wish that he would have popped up.
I can't wait till we see Corporate King.
Corporate Baylor. Side note. So there's some news here in Pennsylvania. Where our attorney general has like got caught on like 12 counts of fraud or something like that, and has had to step down and all this stuff, right? Her name is Kane. And it comes
That's
up.
It's gotta be Kane.
It comes up on the news tonight, and then just her picture, and I have no context for this thing, and then they play it again like the next half hour later. When I'm half paying attention, I'm preparing for the show. And yeah, when she popped up, I had no idea. And it was just like, it gotta be Kane. Gotta be Kane.
Okay. Sword. I thought you were going somewhere else with this. You took a look at last year's SummerSlam card.
Right.
You want to know what last year's Takeover card was and how much of that looks like SummerSlam this year?
Ooh, enlighten me, Mike. This can't be any way similar or any such
well,
way.
Okay. So let's just break down all these people that are on the main roster right now, okay?
Okay. Okay, Mike.
The first match was Tyler Breeze versus Jushin Liger.
Wait, what? That. Wait, yeah. Wait, I forgot that happened. Holy shit.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, that happened. Half that match is on the card. It's on the main roster.
Right.
The Vaudevillains with Blue Pants, Blake and Murphy with Alexa Bliss. Half of that match is on the main roster.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Apollo Crews beat Ty Dillinger. Half of that match is on the main roster. Samoa Joe beat Baron Corbin. There's a theme here. Half of that match is on the main roster.
And it's not the half you expect.
Nope, definitely not. Bailey defeated Sasha Banks. Half of that match is on the main roster.
And the other half.
And the only outlier, Finn Balor defeated Kevin Owens. All of that match is on the main roster.
I also want to point out, half of that other match, Bailey showed up on the main roster last month. So,
exactly. So yeah. Technically, she could debut at SummerSlam after she loses to Asuka. We don't know.
Yeah.
NXT has changed a hell of a lot more than the main roster has in a year.
Well, naturally.
This is the way it's supposed to run, though.
It's just shocking.
This is the experiment coming to fruition, right? And what Triple H's little pet project Skunk Works down here in Orlando, Florida, has become the main stage, and it's fantastic, and we get to enjoy all parts of it instead of trying to dig up tapes from Bright House Cable in Florida. They're trying to figure out who this Seth Rollins guy is, okay? This is the way.
I guess you could really say that NXT took over.
God damn it, Wheels. I mean, you're right, but still. God damn it.
It's what they meant all along. It's all about the game and how you play it. Guys, what did you learn from pro wrestling this week?
I learned that I really love Naomi's entrance now.
Oh, that is
a kick-ass entrance.
That is a lot of fun. Raver Naomi is pretty fantastic.
Yeah. That was like, dude, that is better than Jericho jacket.
Mm-hmm. Oh God, it's all blacklight shit, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it's great. It's really
okay.
Great.
Okay, all right.
Even Eamon's like, yeah, it's great.
No, it is. It's really good.
All right. I learned that there will never be another Undertaker, no matter how many easy layups they give you for another Undertaker. We've had an easy layup with Bray Wyatt that they've flubbed. We had an easy layup on Monday with the Demon Finn Balor, and they flubbed. They could have had this be something creepy, where he was stalking Seth the whole night, and he just ran out and they fought. Like, no. It could have been something so much more. Instead, it's just like, oh yeah, he's a guy in face paint.
Well, that paint takes a while, Mike. He probably had to take 3 hours to put it all on.
Yeah. That shit peels, and that's the thing with the Balor thing, is like, I realize, like, here's the thing. People don't realize how long it takes for him to do that. How long it takes for him to put himself in that. If he's going to do it for a match, he's not going to run the whole show.
Hey, but you know what? Goldust does it to play Pokemon Go.
Goldust has his face just paints his face. He doesn't paint the entire body. And then, like, you know, there's a difference.
Goldust does it when he's not booked.
Well, good for Goldust, okay?
I'm just saying, Finn has to do it once a month. And plus, this isn't on Finn. This is on the writers. They could have done something really interesting with it. Instead, it's just like, oh, do your normal demon entrance and go out and fight.
Mike, I don't give you any room to complain about the same further until we see what they do with him at SummerSlam. I think we'll
that's
have
the difference. They're not going to bust that
fantastic at SummerSlam.
Like, in fairness, I wish they would have just not done it on Raw.
There was a very
exactly. They shouldn't have done it on Raw.
I talked about this on the wrap up. Justin LaBarre had a very good point. They said, well, we've been talking about this and explaining it and everything, and you have, 1.5 million people on WWE Network, and over 3 million people are watching Monday Night Raw. We have to expose them to what the deal is, even if that is the only time that we're going to do it on Raw, right?
And I understand that. I understand that whole point, but there's a better way to do it to actually make it look mysterious and threatening. Because they gave away, like, half of what the match is going to be like.
You're just mad because it's Corpus Christi. Eamon, what did you learn?
Yeah, Corpus isn't there. I learned from wrestling this week that working in wrestling it puts you in a really weird position. When you see somebody you're friend with, who you work with every month, and you're excited to see them get their ass kicked.
Hashtag
Rachel Levy or whatever her name was. But yeah. No, she was awesome, and I was very excited to see her, and even to get to see her cut a promo, which is crazy. If you listen to her past interviews on the Andy Mayhem show with her, she's awesome. So go support her, and then go check her out.
I loved it, because it was still the Delilah Doom character for the most part. Like, she was that super
upbeat. Yeah, like, her look.
I'm just like she's talking, and I'm like, this is the girl that we talked to. Like this is, like, not like a character. Like, no, this is the girl we talked to. You know, mm-hmm. like 3 times on the show. Like, that's her. And even knowing what's coming, you know, that's awesome. I love that the picture going around of her unconscious on the floor with the hashtag Doomies Never Die that's been going around by your camp over there. That's pretty fantastic. So, I don't know. All right. From the Twitter, our friend Red Setter 478 says Heath Slater is a down on his luck father who is trying to be good and provide. So Shane and Daniel call CPS for laughs.
Oh, by the way, Sorg, I wasn't able to watch SmackDown tonight. I did some preliminary calculations on how many children Heath Slater has.
Mm-hmm. Oh boy.
8.5.
A half?
A half. The half, he's not sure he's the father or not.
Oh, okay. West Virginia.
It's a Maury Povich situation.
West Virginia.
Yeah, exactly. West Virginia.
somebody, I forget which night it was, but somebody was very, very insistent on insisting that he married his cousin or something because he's from West Virginia. It got really annoying. But anyways. From the Facebook, Bobby F. J-Town learned that Brock Lesnar doesn't give a shit about Heath Slater's poll either. Alex Cars out in California, not PA, California. He learned that it feels real good to go to a local indie wrestling show after all these months, especially when doing so involves stepping out of your comfort zone. Context, he took a lift to and from the show for the first time. There you go. That is the poor man's. That is the poor man's limousine right there. Drew in here says he learned that Demon Kane is wondering why Seth keeps calling him out. Disgusting. Kiko learned that Kenny Omega won't die in the ring and is just here for the money, the fame, and the ladies. Guys, I learned this week that Heath Slater is going to be the most like you know how we kind of look at Kane and Mark Henry and is like, holy crap, those guys are still around. Heath Slater is going to be that guy. It's going to be 2025 and Heath Slater is going to still be around doing amazing things. He has found his longevity and I think Santino would have been around too if he didn't get injured, to be quite honest. So yeah, I think certainly. And presuming Heath Slater didn't get multiple concussions all at one time from his Brock Lesnar encounter. But anyways, that's where I'm at with that. Guys, it's been a blast. So much fun hanging out with you Tuesday nights, talking pro wrestling. Eamon Payton, Eamon 2 Please on the Twitter. He is the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling. Please go check out Inspire Pro Wrestling on the website on Smart Mark Video if you want to hear his voice. All kinds of cool stuff. And
yes.
Awesome people coming.
And also, go check us out on youtube.com/InspireProVideo. We literally just posted a match today with two friends of the show. One of them, as we aforementioned, faced Nia Jax on Raw. And you should check it out. It's really fun.
Awesome. Mad Mike 4883 on the Twitter.
That's me, Sork.
Mm-hmm.
Midweek I'm going to be live tweeting Impact tomorrow night.
Yes.
I'm not expecting to enjoy it.
Say Impact tomorrow night?
Oh, no. Impact is on Thursday. Whenever it's on, I'm still going to be live tweeting it. I've heard some things, Sork.
Uh-oh. What are you talking about?
They're not good things.
So this involves a former Sandow.
Undecided.
Undecided.
I don't even know.
Undecided.
It involves mixed martial arts, Sork.
Oh, because that always works out so well. Mm-hmm. Hot Wheels.
That always works out the best.
He is with the Renegade Wrestling Alliance, RWALive.com. Thank you so much for joining us again.
Hey, thank you for having me, Sorg. It was great to be back.
Of course, I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitters. You can hit me up over there. Everything else, WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe, rate, review. Check out the Patreon. Check out the shirts. I think there's still a sale. It might be a couple days left in it. But we've been tweeting out sales for Spreadshirt and also IndieWrestling.us. The sales going on over there for the next week. Drop us a line 412-206-WMS0. Good times.
Good times.
At WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Thank you, everybody. Join us live at WrestlingMayhemShow.com in the chat room, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, live after SmackDown Live. We'll see you guys next week. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com. Guys are cool.